Celebrate 100 years of America's national parks this April 9th, 10th, and 11th at Cumberland Gaps, an American memoir. Come face to face with our ancestors and their decisions that altered the course of America. Over 100 reenactors will portray heroes from the past, both known and forgotten, in this living history portrait of the American values of patriotism, bravery, sacrifice, integrity, and hard work. This park event will also feature the treasure keepers from today. Celebrate with rangers from Yosemite National Park, New Orleans Jazz National Historical Park, and others at the 100th anniversary birthday bash. The event concludes on Monday the 11th with the U.S. Mint launching of the America the Beautiful Quarter for Kentucky, featuring Cumberland Gap National Historical Park. Come experience all of this and more at An American Memoir, April 9th, 10th, and 11th. For more information, call the park or check our website at nps.gov/CUGA.
You didn't know you were going to be on television today, did you? All right. Well, it's a pleasure for me to be here and to get a chance to talk about one of your own. When we talk about the giant, I've written about him some, and I've got an article here that was in the Kentucky Humanities Magazine, and I've got a couple other articles that are waiting to be published. They were going to publish one last month in the Kentucky Monthly, but that fat kid from Harlan that won The Voice got on the cover and stole my space. More power to him. I didn't say that. More power to him. But one of the things you find out when you work with magazines and publishers is they're about as honest as politicians. So you can't believe what they say. They're going to sell out to the highest price. And I talked to a book publisher Thursday morning at 8, so we're working on some book material, too, out of all this. And hopefully we'll get it out with the websites that you all have, there's, 1,400 on one, and this new one got a whole bunch already, too. So everywhere I turn anymore, I see articles about the Giants or Bad John. But we're going to talk about the Giant today. Maybe we'll come back another time and talk about Bad John. Let's see. We're in Pound, and we're going to be talking about the giant who was born just across the state line in Letcher County. It was when he was born, it was Perry County. When he was five, the counties divided up and became Letcher at that time. And we're going to talk about, do you all know where Martha Jane Potter School is now? That was the family farm. And if you come up from there, I don't know, 8 or 10 miles, there's a two-story house on the left on 15, and that was John's place. It was a log house at the time. So that was about how close neighbors were in those days, because they were related. The giant was the uncle, and Bad John was the nephew. He'd married one of the giant's sisters. I mean, his mother was one of the giant's sisters. And so if we go back in time, let me mentally take you back in time, push your time machine button, and think about what it was like here in the early 1800s. A lot of space between neighbors. You didn't go to the store to buy your hamburger. You shot it and processed it and did all that yourself. And you raised your own food in the garden. And you had a lot of kids to help with the chores at home. And if you went to school at all, you went somewhere short of 6 months, some places 3 months, some places 6 months, and the kids would come barefoot and would be local children. And so there wasn't a lot of education. There weren't a lot of churches. The Presbyterians were leaders in getting in here. Social services were non-existent. There might be one lawyer to a town, one doctor to a town, and so forth. Whitesburg at that time was about 75 people. Hazard was about 75 to 100. And so you have a population that gets by hard work and their own ingenuity. If they can't figure it out, they're not going to survive. And there's no law enforcement. So if you can't cooperate and get an agreement with your neighbor, then you're likely going to be in some kind of a feud or shooting match. All right, so this is the situation that we're in. Everywhere you go, you're going to go on foot, or you're going to go on horseback, or you're going to go on a jolt buggy or a sled pulled by a horse. So you're not going to get out much. But there's nothing else around you. It's you and your family. So there's a lot of good things to say about it, too. But as far as civilization, wasn't like any other place. So this must be the place that we're talking about. All right. Well, let me talk. I'm going to read a little bit and then talk a little bit. Keep me on track and keep my dementia down that way. All right. So this article was called A Giant Love Story, How the Tallest Couple in the World Met and Married. Martin Van Buren Bates was born in 1837 in the mountains of Letcher County, as far down against Virginia as the map allows. He was the last child born to John Willis and Sarah Waltrip Bates. John stood 6'2", which was tall for his day, and Sarah was 5 feet tall and weighed 150 pounds. So people were a little smaller in those days. And so the giant's going to come along and he's going to really turn the tables and on all that. So together, John and Sarah worked a good-sized farm that was bordered on the east by the North Fork of the Kentucky River and on the south by Boone Fork, a creek named for Daniel Boone, who had explored there a generation earlier. Martin was born of normal size to parents and siblings of normal size. John Jr. was born first, followed by Margaret in 1815 and Martha. Eliza Agnes came next, then brothers Jesse, James, and Robert. Not Jesse James, but Jesse and James. And Uriah in 1828. Sarah Ann was born in 1830, followed by Henderson, and Mary Jane in 1836. Among the dozen children, several were lean and lanky, but none was considered large. So here we are in this area, this piece of land that you all know where it is. There's a school there now, but before they could plow it, they could raise crops. There were bear and deer and elk running through it that they could shoot. There was fish in the creeks on both sides. And so for a large family, this was a good piece of land. You know, it's sort of a bottom right in through there. Mountains on the sides, and so kind of protected from the outside by the water and by the mountains. And in this environment, here comes this last child. And he's at birth, he's no different from the rest of them. So they're expecting him to grow up and do chores and, you know, be a contribution that's positive to the family unit. And they're expecting no surprises. Is that, parents, isn't that what you want? No surprises. First thing you do is you count the toes and the fingers, and after that, just no surprises. That's what we want. All right. So across the nation at that time came the Panic of 1837, which lasted for 7 years and featured high inflation, wild land speculation, hundreds of bank closings, and thousands of business failures. The panic resulted from the economic policies of U.S. President Andrew Jackson. The biggest decision was to close the Second Bank of the United States, which was resulted in a disruptive downward spiral in the U.S. economy. His policies were seen as profitable, though, for people living in the West, and the West was Tennessee and Kentucky at that time. So besides farming, John Bates earned money by trading land. You all know that Bad John traded land, lots of it. President Jackson's efforts allowed Bates to borrow money at terms favorable for buying and selling land. Jackson was leaving office, but one of his major supporters would become the new president of the United States. To honor the elfish New York Dutchman, John christened his 12th child, Martin Van Buren Bates.
Hey everyone, welcome today. We're so glad you dropped by. We're going to start out today a little bit different, and the reason we're going to do that, I'll explain to you just in a few minutes. First of all, we're going to do a palette that's laying down over here. Most of our paintings that we do on the show is what I call a one-hand painting. We do them with one hand usually, and don't use the left hand at all hardly. But anyhow, today, come over to the board now and I'll show you what we've got. We've got this is a finished drawing, actually. You probably could use this the way it is if you wanted to. But anyhow, we're going to paint it, and the reason the palette's laying down is because we need to do a lot of detail in it, so I'll need to hold my hand closer and use both hands in order to get to the detail that we want. But first of all, we'll start as we normally do. We'll mix up some color. I'm going to take a little white. I'm going to pull it way over here. Well, let's put it right here. I'm going to take a little blue. Now, that's a real pretty blue, but I'm going to put just a touch of crimson in it. I like to have just a little bit. Okay, that's good enough. Now, I don't know if that's enough color or not, but we're going to start out with that. And we'll rinse our brush out. We have oil in all of our brushes, by the way. Now I'm going to try to be pretty neat here. I'm dropping a little thinner there. Let me wipe that just a little bit. And I'll wipe my canvas just a little bit there. No, over here. I'm not sure how far down we'll make that. Now I'm going to try not to go over my building here because this is a finished drawing. And I'll show you why we'll do that, why I'm doing that in a few minutes. Now I want that a little lighter, so I'm going to just reach over and grab a little white. We'll go right around that, and I'm pulling it pretty close, if you'll notice what I'm doing. I'm trying to go around most of that because I've already got my detail there, and I'll show you why we'll do that just in a few minutes. Now I'm going to put a little sky back here. We might put some kind of trees or something in there, but I'm going to add a little bit of, just a little bit. Now pull it down probably a little bit farther than I need to. Okay, now I'm gonna pull a line right on top of this little building. This is Jim's saloon, by the way. Now I'm taking pains to sort of go around everything. Now I want to pick up just a little white. Let me show you what we'll do here. That's just to give us a little bit of detail in there. You don't need a whole lot back here because we don't want people actually staring at this part because the painting is where the interest is at down here where the... And some people say that's two gunfighters. Well, it could be, but you know what it could be? Could be two friends going to shake hands. Okay, now that's just add a little bit of detail in the sky back there.
All right, everybody, my name's Colin. I'm a member of the Western Band of Cherokee Nation. All the stuff you see here on the table, the log, is arrowheads and spear points that I make traditionally by hand myself. They're items that we would hunt with and even go to battle with. They were very, very important to us because without these things here, you see, we would have starved, maybe even died, you know, from not having it. So anything that we could use, you know, maybe to hunt or kill, then once we got a deer or a buffalo or elk or whatever, we would use every bit of it. Like, let me show you. This fish hook, it's carved out of deer leg. And then I took the same deer leg and made an awl. Which I took the awl and used it to sew this leather sewing kit. See, that's pretty cool, right?
Yeah.
So out of this one piece of bone, I made all that.
Wow.
You wouldn't think out of this one piece of bone you could make all that. And the atlatl that I used to hunt with, here's the tip to it. That's a flint knap tip I made myself. And it's interchangeable. It fits in just like this. So if you're hunting and you drop this or you miss by chance and it breaks, you don't have to untie it and redo it and everything else. You can just take one out of your pocket and put it right back in. How it works is you hook that piece of deer antler right in the tip, hold it with your two fingers, and it launches. And it's accurate and efficient up to about 100 yards if you have the arm to throw it. And then when it sticks into the animal, and they take off running. This drops and it's laying on the ground. You pull one out of your side bag, put it right back in, and you're ready to go again. Now, that's the lady I was telling you about.
I figured that was the lady he's been looking for.
She grinds up our corn on that grinding stone, makes cornmeal, and that's how we're going to be cooking later.
Anything else you want to tell us?
No, that's what we got here, but if you do have any questions, just feel free to ask, and I'll be more than happy to answer them for you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Good visit.
Okay. Bezom leno enila sewine natu fele iti. Oh, forgive me, do not speak the language of my father's Algonquin. What I said was, hello, I am Shawnee, I'm the great warrior Tall Tree. Now, that is Algonquin language that was spoken by the Shawnee, and unfortunately it's a dying language today. I portray a Euro-American adoptee of the Shawnee people. That means I was born of white parents. I was taken as a very young child by a war party who took me back to the Ohio country where I was adopted. When I was adopted, they plucked my hair, they pierced my nose, and they pierced my ears, putting earrings and nose rings in my nose and my ears. And so I grew up as a Shawnee. And this was common practice in the 18th century to take captives for adoption. There were many different reasons. One was for ransom. One was to regenerate the populations of their nation, because of the fact that by the time of the revolution, their nations were being decimated by warfare and by European diseases such as smallpox and typhoid and so on and so on. And the last reason was for sacrifice. Basically, what the Cherokee called blood law. The Shawnee people, for instance, when they would sacrifice, that there was a wrong or an insult done that apologies wouldn't do for, they would sacrifice a captive. And so I got lucky and was adopted. And everything I wear, including my nose rings, my earrings, is pretty correct to what Shawnee people would look like at this time, including a lot of my tattoos. My tattoos are marks of distinction, whether or not you're a warrior or had moved into the political arena after you were too old to be a warrior. And so, that's about it, I guess.
Okay. From
well, what I'm portraying is a Shelaghi warrior, Cherokee, as you would say. And of course, we're in the boundary line of the Cherokee people. And in this time period, the Cherokee were selling off Kentucky. And later today and tomorrow, we're going to be portraying the discussion between a group of surveyors talking about it. It's the Treaty of Sycamore Shoals, where Judge Richard Henderson purchased what was Kentucky country for 10,000 pounds sterling from the Cherokee leaders over here at Sycamore Shoals or Bristol, Tennessee today. And what we're going to represent is we've run into them and they're trying to convince us of the benefit of this treaty to us, which would be the trade goods and the material wealth that represents versus the land that we're giving up or giving up in a sense. Now, many of the people who are not at that treaty will not hold themselves responsible for that treaty agreement. So that was sort of a rule of thumb. It's only with the people that were there. So once that treaty is signed, Kentucky was actually claimed by other tribes as hunting ground as well. So Henderson took a big risk doing this, and the Cherokee people took a big risk as well, giving it up. This was winter hunting ground, very rich land. The bluegrass of Kentucky was known to be some of the richest hunting ground in the world. So We're here portraying that, and as he, everything I've got on is typical, from the match coat to the red British top coat, the wool leggings. By this point, the Cherokee are very in the Euro material culture world, in terms of everything they wore and everything they handled, weaponry and such, and being British allies since way before the French Indian War. obviously, you know, we've got that material relationship with them, and that will carry on into the American Revolution to the Cherokee's demise, almost siding with the British. So, that's it.
All right, I think we're going to get started. I believe everybody has a seat somewhere. But today is a great day. We are thrilled that you all have taken time to come out and be with us today as we celebrate our ribbon cutting for the Robert E. Frazier Broadcast Center and the official relaunch of Southeast TV. This day has been a personal goal of mine for some time. In 2003, I started my career at Southeast as the Southeast TV program coordinator. After completing my degree, I moved on to other things, and I left in 2004. But when I returned in 2006 to accept a new position, I found the studio to be sitting idle. Every time I walked past these doors, a piece of my heart sunk. I knew the potential that sat there, and I knew that one day she would be restored to her original glory. Well, folks, today is that day. At this time, I'd like to welcome Dr. Lynn Moore, President of Southeast Kentucky Community and Technical College.
Thank you so much. It's so great to be here. I have to share with you, I just left our Pineville campus. We had one of our open forums over there. And boy, we had some students that are very inquisitive, and quite a few of them were graduating, and they said, you know, what can we do for the college as we're leaving to help it be all that it can be? And I have to share with you also, they got into a bragging contest about our college and about our faculty and our staff. And I just had to share that with you right off, because so many times we're faced with unfortunate situations. The budget, the finance is never gonna be what it needs to be. But wow, it was amazing to hear those students say, you know, we love our faculty, we love our college, we're graduating. And we actually had one student who pointed to one of the second year students and says, you know, I had to take my child over to one of the clinics, and said, I didn't realize that this was a second year student that was working on my child. It was taking, you know, doing the x-ray piece and everything for my child, and said, I want everybody to know how professional she was and how amazing she was. And of course, the student was shocked. She said, well, I didn't know you were a student too, you know? So the point is, what we do here is just amazing.
I have to say a special thanks to Dr. Ayers. He was my mentor. He was like a father to me when I was here. And I tell you what, I don't think I'd went as far as I have without you, sir. So I really appreciate you. When I say that being back here at Southeast is being like being back at home, I mean it. Southeast TV is where it all started. It was the first place I ever did weather. It was the first place I trained on how to use camera equipment, editing equipment. It was the place that started my career. It's now spanned almost the better part of a decade. So I'm really proud and proud to be back here where it all began. Over the past 4 months, since we got our Frazier grant in December, we have worked tirelessly trying to get our new and state-of-the-art equipment in place in order to launch the Frazier Broadcast Center. We are using industry standard. You will find the same equipment here that you find in major market TV stations, just like before in June of 2000 when they launched the first time. You will also find students who are already working here, just like before. We've got two in the back back there. Gentlemen, stand up a minute. Shane Watts and Jacob Krager, that's two more questions. Southeast TV gear, and hopefully these students, along with many others, will be able to learn the tricks of the trade like I did so many years ago. Let me tell you about the equipment we have right now. We have the ability to shoot and edit either HD or 4K. 4K is the top of the line right now. You can't get any higher when it comes to video quality. We have a system called the TriCaster, and the TriCaster is basically a digital switcher. It allows you to create virtual sets. It allows you to be on a news set. It allows you to be in the Amazon. It allows you to be anywhere. You can be on just the chroma key wall in there. So we gives us the ability to basically be anywhere we want to be, all without leaving this campus and right here in Harlan County. We have two chroma key walls, and what chroma key walls are, if you don't know, that's the walls that weather people stand in front of. That's the easiest way I can say to describe it to you. You can project via computer anything onto those walls. We have a blue one and a green one, and you'll see those if you get to wander through here a little bit. And that gives us the ability to do anything right here that you could do in a major market television station. Those two chroma key walls are separate sets. They allow us to do the have flexibility to do the same or do two different things at the same time. So you can shoot a news virtual set and a weather segment all in the same newscast without leaving the same room. Pretty neat. We can also do commercial shooting, which we will be getting into at some point, or we can project any particular scene, like I mentioned before, behind talent. We have three of those studio 4K cameras in-house. We have five that we use for the field. So students will be shooting on the newest technology. There's no old equipment here. We've went all out because I tell you what, if they go out into this field, that's what they're going to be using eventually. Those will allow us to go out in the community and cover different events. We've already been doing some of that. We have an editing station in place, a whole edit booth back there that allows us to digitize all of our tape archive. We have a lot of tape still. We're in the process of digitizing all that. That's history. We don't want that to be lost in the passage of time. And eventually, those tapes are going to start to degrade, so that's one of our priorities right now. We have wireless mics for our talent. That allows them to be mobile and have the ability to use any of our sets. We have three of those, which you'll see a little bit during the broadcast. Here's the most important thing, and they have started this back near Dr. Ayers' vision. We have the ability, and we should be right now. Are we streaming, Jay? We are streaming live right now to the internet. So anybody in the world can log on, and you'll get little cards later on if you haven't already that have our website on that where you can see our stream. That's 24 hours a day. If something happens, we'll be back as soon as we can. So right now, 24 hours a day with that. We will soon have the ability to go live from the field. All we have to have is a little red box and a camera. We can go live from anywhere we have wireless internet or cell phone service. How neat is that? Although we're just getting started, we're already on the move. We've been covering campus events since late last year, and we're hoping to expand very quickly in the community now that we have everything in place. Our goal is to be everywhere, to make Southeast TV a household name, just like our friends over WYMT. We've partnered with groups across the country to gain access to educational and entertaining content, and you'll see a lot of different content we've pulled from several different places if you start watching this week. And that's starting to air on the channel today. Hopefully in the beginning we'll have at least about 12 hours a day of content. Some of it might be repeated right now. Our friends at ARC TV are helping us get some of that going too. So give us time. We'll get it filled up eventually. And then the other 12 hours a day will be community count. So if you have events you'd like us to advertise, send them to us. I've got a little video that I'm going to show here in just a second that shows what's kind of been going on behind the scenes a little bit, and it's some of the history you already heard, but it kind of gives you a little bit of a video perspective of what's been going on the last few months. Hopefully this video will make you as excited to see it as it did for me to put it together for you. The future is waiting, and we are more than ready for the journey. 16 years ago, then Southeast Community College President Dr. Bruce Ayers had a vision for a state-of-the-art broadcasting center located right here in the heart of Eastern Kentucky. The $1.2 million center would have all the tools and technology available to major market television stations at the time. It would set out to become a conduit for the college, not only to pass along educational and local content to the area, but to bring communities together through television. In late June of 2000, that vision became a reality. Southeast TV was born soon after, serving up local programming to the community first by closed-circuit television and then to the city of Cumberland via Access Cable Channel 37. Students produced everything from daily news broadcasts to entertainment talk shows alongside educational programming. The program thrived, boasting a student video team of almost 40 people at its peak and offering associate's degrees with a telecommunications emphasis to several of those students. Unfortunately, due to staff departures in 2005, the program was put on the back burner and the station was shuttered. The facility sat idle for the better part of 10 years, only coming back to life around Christmas time each year to host the annual Tri-City Empty Stocking Fund auction, which helps local families in need. In 2015, current president Dr. Lynn Moore made the decision to bring SETV back. I was hired as the newly minted director of media and communications, with one of my primary job responsibilities being the revitalization of the studio. With the help of the Robert E. Fraser Foundation and a generous $50,000 grant, Southeast TV is once again state-of-the-art. While the technology and equipment are new, the mission is the same as it always has been, to offer local and educational programming to the area, to be here when you need us, to help spread the message of the college both near and far, to connect the community through television.
There are a lot of things in the works around here, so stick around. I know you're going to enjoy what we have to offer. With that being said, it is my honor to flip the switch once again, launching us into a new era of educational and community television. Broadcasting from the Robert E. Frazier Broadcast Center on the Cumberland campus of Southeast Kentucky Community and Technical College, you're watching Southeast TV. Thanks for tuning in.
Since 1977, Pike County has been celebrating Hillbilly Days. This nationally known annual event is a fundraiser to benefit the Shriners Children's Hospital in Lexington, Kentucky, held in downtown Pikeville. This is one festival you'll got to see to believe. Superior artists and craftspeople showcase their talent and their handiwork amidst mountain music, clogging, and square dancing. Men, women, and youngsters pick and grin while trying to outdo each other with their wild hillbilly outfits. So come join the Hillbilly Days 2016 in downtown Pikeville. You're watching ARC TV.
Why don't you introduce yourself and what library we're at?
My name's Randy. I'm at the Floyd County Public Library in Prestonsburg. We are trying to have more and more events where authors come, and Mr. Prather reached out to me from what the information he's given me and what we've used is to promote his event. As he's done an extreme amount of research on his subject and on what he's written about, and we're happy to have him here, Mr. Prather. We're glad you came to Prestonsburg. I'd love to hear what you got to say, hope everybody will enjoy.
Mr. Robert Prather.
Thanks, sir.
Come on in, sit down. Come on in.
Thank you, Randy. Come right on in, sir. As Randy has told you, my name's Robert Prather, author of The Strange Case of Jonathan Swift and the Real Long John Silver. Probably one of the longest titles you'll ever see in a book, and it does get kind of tiresome writing that whenever I tell people what the book title is. But that's the one my publisher chose, and I think they made a good choice on it. It kind of captures at least part of the meaning of what's in the book. I'd like to thank Randy Reno for allowing me to come out today and speak to the good folks of Prestonsburg about a local legend here. Pretty much spreads all the way through the eastern portion of Kentucky, the Swift Silver Mine legend. And let me compliment you on your beautiful town. Prestonsburg is certainly a beautiful spot. And you have a nice facility here as well in your library.
Thank you.
Show of hands, has anybody here heard of the Swift Silver Mine legend? Got one here. Okay, I'm a little surprised that more of you haven't heard of this. This is an area that typically there's a pretty high percentage of people that have heard about Swift and his activities in this country. There's a lot of different aspects regarding the legend of Swift. most of the information that we get about him comes from folk tradition. It's been handed down from people to people through the generations. And it basically began in the 1780s regarding Swift. The first mention of Swift actually occurred in 1788, the mention of Swift and a silver mine. And it was due to the gentleman that you see on the screen here, who was Kentucky's first historian and cartographer, mapmaker, John Filson. In 1788, John Filson and a gentleman by the name of Robert Breckinridge took out what was the first of a four-step process to have land granted from the state of Virginia to the individual. Filson and Breckinridge took out a land entry, is what that first step is called. And Filson also is a piece of the mystery that surrounds the Swift legend, there's a great deal of mystery that surrounds the legend. One is, where was his vast treasure that people are talking about? That was the bulk of the stories, was all about Swift and a group of men that came to eastern Kentucky primarily. You'll hear spots where they came other than eastern Kentucky, but he's primarily associated with areas from Alexandria, Virginia, through West Virginia today, and then eastern Kentucky. Just so happens John Filson, as I mentioned, in 1788 took a land entry, and it mentions on the entry that the land was to be laid out in a square to the cardinal points of the compass, and in the center of the property was to be a silver mine. And part of the old crucible was left there, the old smelting furnace, and he was made aware of this by a man named Swift. So this was 1788, and it's widely believed and pretty much known that this is the first connection between Swift and a silver mine somewhere in Kentucky. Part of the mystery, as I mentioned, is due to the fact that the same year that Filson took out the land entry was the very year of his disappearance. And it's often been said that his disappearance was directly related to the Swift silver mine and some of the shenanigans that was going on pertaining to that. The difference between my book and what has really been written about Swift up to this point is that I branch out from the existing tradition stories, the legends and all that that's held by locals from Alexandria to this area, there's actually pocket areas in seven different states that are familiar with the Swift legend, that he is actually connected with it. And once I'll make sure that everybody here today gets a treasure map for coming out, and it's referred to as the Swift's treasure map, and it's not, of course, an authentic map, but it is in a way, which I'll explain that more later. It marks all the different spots that he actually owned land in Kentucky and Virginia. This is, what you see on the screen here, the original land entry between Robert Breckinridge and John Filson as tenants in common. Talks about that the very vague as far as where the property was. Mentions that it was 60 miles, 60 or 70 miles northeastwardly from Martin's cabin, which today we know is in the westernmost part of Virginia. Also mentions here a certain man named Swift. Reports that he has extracted from the mine some silver. And, of course, Filson and Breckenridge were very interested in this. There, during this time, it didn't take long where a frenzy, I guess you would call it, started. It was a bit like the gold rush of the West, the 49ers, where people started coming into Kentucky looking for Swift's treasure. Another gentleman that's associated with Swift and the silver mine is a gentleman by the name of Gilbert Imlay. Imlay was a historical and very interesting study in his own self, in his own right. This is his map of Kentucky. It's an early one. This is just an inset of the bigger map. And it shows here, you can see where it says reputed silver mines. Also, it shows here a great salt spring. This is all very important because it fits into the puzzle that once you find out some other things, it becomes very important. Now, I hate to say it, but it's the truth that most people, historians, geologist, have pretty much written off any possibility that Swift found any sort of silver or gold.